In this lecture, we will consider the definition of rules of inference, what exactly rules of inference are, and we will also talk about the different types of inference rules. Let's dive into the definition of rules of inference. First of all, in order to understand the definition of rules of inference, we need to understand what exactly inference is. Inference means deriving conclusions from evidences. Please remember, it is actually deriving conclusions from evidences. Now, evidences are the premises. We already know they are the assumptions. On the basis of those assumptions, we are trying to derive conclusions, and that is what inference is all about, right? Now, what are rules of inference? Rules of inference are the templates for constructing valid arguments. Please note down this point. They are the templates for constructing valid arguments. Basically, rules of inference themselves are the valid arguments, and they are used to construct more complicated valid arguments. And that is what rules of inference is all about. After considering the definition of rules of inference, let's consider different types of inference rules. First rule in this list is modus ponens rule. P implies Q, P therefore Q. What does it really mean? That means when P implies Q is true, and when P is true, then Q has to be true. This is the conclusion, right? Now, if P is true, we know that if P is true, then Q has to be true. It cannot be false. Therefore, conclusion must also be true, right? This is the law of modus ponens. We can also write this argument as P implies Q and P implies Q. We know that these are the premises, that is P implies Q and P. And this is our conclusion, that is Q. And we know that premises always implies conclusion, right? And hence we can write this argument in this form. Okay. Now the second rule in this list is modus tollens rule. According to this rule, P implies Q, not Q, therefore not P. Now, as we know, P implies Q is true and not Q is true. Therefore, we need to conclude that not P is also true. Now, if P implies Q is true and not Q is true, then Q becomes false, right? Now, if Q is false, then P has to be false. It is not the case that P becomes true. Because if P is true, then true implies false is false, right? Now, if P is false, then not P will be true. Therefore, we can say that our final conclusion becomes true. And hence, this argument is a valid argument. Definitely, we can write this argument as P implies Q and not Q implies not P, right? Let's consider the third rule in this list, that is hypothetical syllogism. According to this rule, P implies Q, Q implies R, therefore P implies R. Now, if P implies Q is true and Q implies R is true, then P implies R has to be true. Let's try to make this P implies R false by taking P true and R false. Let's see whether we would be able to make it false or not. Let's take P true and R false. Now, if P is true, then Q cannot be false, right? Q has to be true. And because Q is true, then R cannot be false. Right? Therefore, R has to be true. It cannot be false. Hence, this has to be true. And if R is true and P is true, then true implies true is always true. Therefore, we cannot make P implies R false. And definitely, we can write this argument as P implies Q and Q implies P implies R. Let's consider the fourth rule, that is disjunctive syllogism. P or Q, not P, therefore, Q. Now, let's say P or Q is true and not P is also true. If not P is true, then P becomes false. And if P is false, then Q has to be true. Therefore, finally, the conclusion becomes true. And we can write this argument as P or Q and not P implies Q. Now, let's consider the fifth rule, that is addition rule. P, therefore P or Q. How this argument is valid? When P is true, then definitely this is also true. If this is true, then true or with anything is always true. Then the argument is always satisfied, right? Hence, we can say that this argument is valid. and we can write this argument as P implies P or Q. Let's consider the sixth rule, that is simplification rule. P and Q, therefore P, or P and Q, therefore Q. Or we can write these arguments as P and Q implies P, or P and Q implies Q, right? Now, why these arguments are valid? As P and Q is true, this can be true only when P is true and Q is true. Therefore, we can say that both P is true and Q is also true. And hence, both the conclusions are correct. Hence, we can say that these arguments are valid arguments, right? Let's consider the seventh rule, that is conjunction rule. P, Q, therefore P and Q. Now, if P is true and Q is true, then definitely P and Q becomes true. Right? This is according to the conjunction law, and hence it is a valid argument. We can write this argument as P and Q implies P and Q. Now, let's consider the last rule of this list, that is resolution rule. P or Q, not P or R, therefore Q or R. Now, as P or Q is true and not P or R is also true, therefore we need to conclude that Q or R is also true. How can we prove that? It may be possible that both of them are true, or it may be possible that Q is true or maybe R is true, right? Let's take Q false. And if Q is false, then P has to be true. And if P is true, then not P becomes false. And if not P is false, then R has to be true. Therefore, when Q is false, then R has to be true, right? Now let's take Q true. Let's take P false. If P is false, then not P has to be true. And if not P is true, then R can be true or R can be false. If R is false, then there is no problem because true or with false is always true. And if R is true, then also there is no problem. Therefore, again, Q or R becomes true, right? If we take P true, then not P becomes false, then R has to be true. In that case also, Q or R is true. Hence, we can say that this argument is a valid argument, right? We can write this argument as P or Q and not P or R implies Q or R.